والله يدعو إلى دار السلام ويهدي من يشاء إلى صراط مستقيم.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره، نعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، فإن كل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار، وإنما توعدون لآت وما أنتم بمعجزين. I praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and He's the only one worthy of praise. I seek His help, His guidance, and His forgiveness. I believe in Him and I trust Him. I seek refuge on Almighty Allah from the evil of our passions. Indeed, whomsoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides him to Al-Islam, no one can mislead him after Allah. And whomsoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put him astray, no one can guide him after Allah. I testify openly that there is no deity worthy of worship except Allah Rabbil Alameen. And I testify that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his messenger and the seal of all the prophets, O Muslims. You must know that the best speech is the speech of Almighty Allah, which is Al-Quran. The best guidance is the course of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which is his sunnah. The worst of all affairs is innovation and addition to the religion of Al-Islam. Indeed, every addition to the religion of Al-Islam will lead to hellfire. I adjure you as well as myself to have the taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Fear Allah and don't die unless you are in a state of Al-Islam. After this, I greet you all with the greeting of Al-Islam. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May the peace and the blessing of Almighty Allah be with you all. I would like to welcome you all for classical reading. And today we're going to be reading for a well-known famous book, which is Riyad al-Salihin. This is a book that should be in every house, every Muslim library have to have this book. After the Book of Allah, immediately comes this book. And as we understand, there is no a book which can be perfect other than the Book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You may found some weak ahadith or other ahadith that is not that authentic, but I will encourage you to get the Dar es Salaam publication. This is a book which been introduced to the Muslims, and this version that been published by Dar es Salaam is very good because it been fed by the authentication of Sheikh Muhammad Nasiruddin al-Albani, may Allah send mercy in his soul. It has the Arabic, it has the English, it has a commentary, and also it have authentication of the Hadith. I will encourage every Muslim who listening to me tonight, inshallah, that if you don't have this, try to buy this book and make sure you get Dar es Salaam publication. Inshallah, we're going to be reading from the book Riyad al-Salihin, which by Imam al-Nawawi. This book which you call Garden of the Righteousness. So, inshallah, we praise that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make me and you and all the Muslims among the righteous people. So this is our garden, and this is what we're going to be walking through this garden. a lot of fruits and a lot of flowers and beautiful things that we need to have this nice fresh air, enjoy our eyes and our seeing with all these beautiful flowers. You found everything that you may desire or need to know, inshallah, in this book. Specifically, I'm asking you to get this book, but you're going to read from this. I'm going to read from the Arabic version. In actuality, I'm not going to be reading like usual. I'm only going to refer to some a hadith and give you one line. And after this, I give you some thoughts about this. The first chapter, mostly the great scholars, when they write their books, they write the first chapter about sincerity and intention. Kitab al-Ikhlas. This is what it always that we see in the great scholars' books, that they start with a book, Bab al-Ikhlas wa Ihdar al-Niyya. This chapter concerning sincerity and intention. And this is something very, very important. This intention is our foundation. You could not erect any building without foundation. If you don't have the right foundation, you are not going to be able to erect your building. It's going to be collapse. Therefore, it is very important that we have to have the correct intention, and we have to have a sincerity in our heart whenever we say or we do anything. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allahumma arzuqna al-ikhlas fil qawli wal amal. Ameen. Oh Allah, bless us with sincerity in whatever we say and whatever we do. In actuality, there is a verse here, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying in Surah Al-Bayyinah, verse number five, وَمَا أُمِرُوا إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ مُخْلَصِينَ لَهُ الدِّينَ حُنَفَاءَ. That they only been commanded to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with a total sincerity. And this what been commanded for those who before us. And this what we been commanded. وَمَا أُمْرِوا إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُوا اللَّهِ. Worshipping of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if it's not having sincerity, is not going to be accepted. Therefore, this what the nations before us, and the prophets that came before the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, may the peace and the blessing of Allah be upon him and all the prophets, this has been commanded by Allah to have ikhlas, ibadah of Allah, worshiping Allah, enslave yourself to Allah with devotion, with sincerity, and that you have to have the clear intention. So, therefore, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us ikhlas, sincerity and intention. Intention deals with the heart. And as we understand the ibadat, there is ibadat badaniya, there is ibadat maliya, there is a different forms of ibadah. You worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through your money by giving the charity, the sadaqah, the zakah. You worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with your body, like making salah, going around with the Kaaba, making tawaf. The most important ibadah can be performed for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is by the heart. Maybe sound strange to you, but do you know that iman and the aqidah deals with the heart? So the most important thing before salah, before zakah, is the iman. And the iman is a ibadah, is a form of devotion to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but it's done by the heart. Therefore, the intention, something related with the heart. So the heart is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is focusing and looking to more than he looking to your body. Allah want to see your heart. يَوْمَ لَا يَنْفَعُ مَالٌ وَلَا بَنُونَ إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ. He didn't say بَدَنٍ سَلِيمٍ. So a person can be sick, be can handicap, but the main thing is the inside, the heart. This is the most important thing. So Allah is saying in that day, which is the day of resurrection, the day of judgment, nothing can be beneficial or benefit the person in that day, no children, no wealth, no any relationship, with exception a person who come to Allah with قلب سليم. A solid heart. A solid heart. Is this what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala want? A heart, sound heart. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala looking for. Therefore, my dear respected brothers and sisters, we have to understand that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to have intention, and the intention dealing with the heart, and the heart is very important. Therefore, we have to focus on it. As a result of this, we see the first hadith that we're dealing with, which reported by Amir al-Mu'mineen, Umar ibn al-Khattab, may Allah be pleased with him, is telling us that إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ وَإِنَّمَا لِكُلِّ مْرِئٍ مَا نَوَى. What we understand from this? The hadith is long, but this what we want to relate here, that أعمال, deeds, أعمال is a plural of عمل, are judged according to the intention. So your deeds, whatever that you want to get closer to Allah, is going to be rewarded according your intention, and for every person whatever he attends. Therefore, that we have to understand the importance of intention, and we have to have the intention putting the horse before the cart. Therefore, intention have to be before. If you want to fast, you have to have intention first. You want to make hajj, you want to make wudu, you want to, whatever that you do it to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it have to be intention first. And the intention have to be sincerely only for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالِ بِالنِّيَّاتِ. Indeed, deeds rewarded according intention. And for every person what he attend. So where is your intention? What are you doing? What you lecturing for? What are you giving a sadaqah for? What are you going for hajj for? Is it have to be for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We continue inshallah. Welcome back to our show, and we're talking about intention, which is an act of the heart, and is very important to proceed your ibadah or whatever that you're saying. Now, it's something very important that we have to keep in mind while we're talking about niyyah, intention. Intention have nothing to do with your tongue. Intention is an act of the heart. As example, you may notice some people, they, when they come to start to make salah, say, Nawaitu usalli fard al-zuhr, fardan alayya lillahi al-aliyyi al-azim, four rak'at, mu'tamman bihadha al-imam, al-hanafi al-madhab, da-da-da-da. A long story before he makes salah. I make my intention to pray zuhr four rak'at behind this imam, Shafi'i school, Hanafi school, blah, blah, blah. Has nothing. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he pray, he didn't say any introduction before his salah. Say, Allahu Akbar, he start his prayer. He didn't say, Nawaitu, I made my intention to fast Ramadan. None of this. Therefore, that the intention is something dealing with your heart, has nothing to do with your tongue, and we need to stay away from all this innovation that is not been introduced by the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. As we stated in the first hadith, the deed are judged by intention. I want to give you an example so you can understand what we're talking about. A person just was exercising or was jogging, and after this he come and he decided to take a shower because he's sweating. So, in actuality, he's washing, cleaning up himself, but it's not his intention to make ghusl for Jum'ah. So now when it's Jum'ah, after a couple of hours, he need to take another ghusl. Why? Because the first ghusl, the shower that he took, because he was jogging, he was sweating. So he want to refresh himself. So this is what we see, the importance of the intention is going to make a difference between what is ada and what is ibadah. what is a culture or what is religion, what is a habit, and what is a form of ibadah. Now, if inshallah, I will leave you for you that you go ahead and read this hadith with yourself, inshallah. But we have here another hadith which reported by Aisha. This is the second hadith in the first chapter that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam informing us, يغزو جيش الكعبة فإذا كانوا ببيداء من الأرض يخسف بأولهم وآخرهم. Inshallah, you continue reading the hadith in your book, but the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, in a time, a army will attack the Kaaba. All right? But when, before they reach, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will cause the earth to sink and to swallow all this army. So Aisha was surprised, say, O Prophet of Allah, some of the people, they are not been there in this army for purpose of destroying the Kaaba. So I see people who sailing or buying or whatever it is, they have nothing to do. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, what the meaning is, يُخْسَفُ بِأَوَّلِهِمْ وَآخِرِهِمْ ثُمَّ يُبْعَثُونَ عَلَى نِيَّاتِهِمْ. All of them will be destroyed, but they've been resurrected in the day of judgment according their intention. So this shows us, why did we enroll in such a place? And we have to be careful that we did not be part of the party, the transgressor party. Doesn't matter if it's an army or a club or whatever it is. When a people la takun imma'an, don't be like with the people. If the people do something good, you be with them. Do something bad, you still with them. This is no. You have to have your own methodology, your own foundation. Don't be like, okay, if the people go right, I go right. The people go left, I go left. You could not do this. Otherwise, it be like this. And this one of the prophecies of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He told us about it. It didn't take a place, but we believe that whatever the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying is going to happen, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam وما ينطق عن الهوى. He doesn't speak from his own desire. إن هو إلا وحي يوحى. It is a revelation comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying يغزو جيش الكعبة, that means an army will attack the Kaaba, and Allah will make the earth sink and swallow them. It going to happen. But the point is, what is the intention? Maybe the leaders, maybe the troops, maybe the people in the front lines, this is their intention. But the other people, they will not this intention. Allah will destroy them also, but they will be resurrected in the day of judgment, and they will be judged according their intention. I want to skip some of this ahadith, and inshallah, hopefully that you will read it for yourself. Now we have hadith number 7, which is reported by Abu Huraira. May Allah be pleased with him, that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying, إِنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى لَا يَنْظُرُ إِلَىٰ أَجْسَامِكُمْ وَلَا إِلَىٰ صِوَرِكُمْ وَلَكِنْ يَنْظُرُ إِلَىٰ قُلُوبِكُمْ وَأَعْمَالِكُمْ. Why I'm bringing this hadith under the intention? It's very important. A lot of people stop making salah. Say, brother, it's not by salah, it's not by hijab. Hijab doesn't make me Muslim. Beard doesn't make me Muslim. This is true. Hijab is not Islam. Hijab is part of Islam. Beard is not Islam. Beard is something from Islam. But they use this hadith to give excuse for themselves. Not to make salah, not to wear hijab, not to be a good Muslim. See? They use the term Rabbina Rabbi Qulub. They don't even say Qulub. Say Rabbina Rabbi Qulub. That means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala deals with your heart. It's not the way how you look. It's not the beard. It's not the hijab. This is not right. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, doesn't matter if you are big, fat, small, short, tall, black, white, red. Doesn't matter if you handicap one arm, five fingers. Doesn't matter with Allah. Because Allah doesn't care about your looks. This is what meant. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala yanzur ila qulubikum. And the hadith didn't stop here and said what? وَأَعْمَالِكُمْ. So Allah looks to your heart, and He looks also to your deed. So what kind of Islam that you want to be a Muslim and no deed? So Allah looks to your heart because the intention comes from your heart. And Allah also cares about your deed. So Allah doesn't care about the looks of your bodies, your figure, your shapes. Allah looks to your hearts. Why? Because the intention comes in your heart. And Allah also looks to your deed. Your deed is something very important. Another hadith here we want to bring it, inshallah, hadith number 9. And inshallah, I encourage all of you, get Riyad al-Salihin, Dar al-Salam publication. All right? And you have to have a routine. You and your family sit together and read a chapter twice a week at least and try to understand it. Hopefully that our program, Classical Reading, inshallah, Reading with Riyad al-Salihin, will help you, inshallah, to understand more about it. But specific hadith here, which he reported, and the hadith is authentic. It is in the collection of Imam al-Bukhari and Imam Muslim by Abi Bakr, and this is different from Abu Bakr, okay? It's saying the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِذَا الْتَقَى الْمُسْلِمَانِ بِسَيْفَيْهِمَا فَالْقَاتِلْ وَالْمَقْتُولِ فِي النَّارِ. When two Muslims, they facing each other with the sword, does not have to be a sword, whatever kind of whipping, okay? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says the killer and the one who been killed, both of them go to hellfire. So here again, why O Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Qultu ya Rasulullah, هذا القاتل, this is the killer. He deserves to go to Jahannam, go to hellfire. But why is the victim? Why is the person who been killed?" The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Innahu kana harisan ala qatl sahibi." Again, we go back to the intention. You see? So, both of them killing each other. And this shows us, my dear respected brothers and sisters, the seriousness of fighting. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying, لا ترجعوا بعد كفارا يضرب بعضكم رقاب بعض. Don't turn in your heel after me like a disbelievers killing one another. This is serious crime in Islam. And Islam tells أنه من قتل نفسا بغير نفس, that whosoever kill his soul with no just cause, as if he فكأنما قتل الناس جميعا, as if he kill all mankind. It's so serious. Don't tell me I'm carrying order, I'm only trying to support my family. Don't support your family by enrolling in an army, and after this you go kill other Muslims. This is haram. The Kaaba is so secret. But the blood of the Muslim is more sacred than the Kaaba. So you could not support your family by killing another Muslim. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying two Muslims, they face each other with whipping, killing each other. The victim, the killer, and the one being killed, both of them will go to hellfire. Why, O Prophet of Allah? He said because his intention was to kill his brother, but he shot him first. You see, it's too late. So we understand now about the seriousness of this matter of our intention. Even if you've been killed, but Allah will judge you about your intention. He was more clever. He was faster than you. He shot you. He killed you. You are a victim, but you're going to go to hellfire. Why? Because your intention. Inshallah, my dear respected brothers and sisters, I would like to finish this chapter, inshallah, with a hadith, very serious hadith reported by Abu Huraira. And because the time, I could not read the whole hadith. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying about awwal thalatha tus'aru bihim naru jahannam. And you may find this hadith under another chapter of riya, showing off. Very serious. The first three people will go to hellfire is a hafiz memorizing, a person memorize the Quran, a person who died in the battlefield, a person who gave in charity. But when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings him in the day of judgment, reminds him about the favor that he bestowed in them, ask him, why? What did he do? He say, oh Allah, I fought in your cause until I was murdered. He say, you are a liar. You did this because people can say that you are a brave person. And after this will be dragged to hellfire. Until I see you today, next time, inshallah, may I beg Allah forgiveness for me and you. And I'm your host, Muhammad Saad Adli, Columbia, South Carolina, United States. Until I see you, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.